It may look like a parade to the casual observer, but to the Confederated Tribes of Warm Springs, this parade signifies the beginning of their celebration for the Paiute powwow. It is one of the ways to continue to restore tradition and pride to Native youth and to all who participate. Today, more than ever, adults and elders of the Nine Tribes of Oregon are seriously concerned with substance abuse and alcoholism in the younger generations, specifically underage drinking, which rum research is a gateway drug. It's an ongoing problem, and they are using a unique set of tribal practices to address the issue. Heritage and culture, because culture is prevention.
Substance abuse is a big problem that's all over everywhere, not just in Indian country, but our teenagers every day, they struggle with that decision. And so giving them an alternative to, instead of going out to a party, have them come here and be with their families and be with their friends and celebrate as Native people and just have something else to do, have an alternative than going to a party or going to get high.
National research suggests that although American Indian adolescents are as likely as non-American Indian youth to use alcohol, they use alcohol more frequently and drink more heavily when they do use alcohol. American Indian youth often use alcohol in combination with drugs and have a high prevalence of psychiatric disorders and emotional problems, leading to more instances of suicide. This event, the Paiute Powwow, is a celebration of the Confederated Tribes of Warm Springs Treaty that was signed in 1855. All of the Nine Tribes of Oregon have powwows to celebrate who we are as sovereign nations. Powwows like this one consist of a weekend full of singing, dancing, and other activities. Celebrating is a reminder to everyone, especially the kids, that life on or off the reservation is better when you remember your roots. Powwows are a powerful tool.
We started a powwow club and we taught the kids how to dance, learn the different songs, the different dances that go with that, the stories behind the dances, and then we also taught them how to make outfits, how to sew, do beadwork, make everything that they needed for to have a full powwow regalia. The Paiute people were always very traditional with their spiritual ways and their round dance singing and dancing and celebrations.
Culture, that's the prime thing, heritage, resurrecting that and bringing them that back, that identity. Even if we disagree about everything else, that's the one thing the scientific prevention people agree about, but that's also the thing the community, the local communities agree on too.
All of our dances have stories behind them and meanings behind them, and so we teach them those things before they become dancers, before they start their outfits, because it's really important to know how to take care of yourself, how to respect yourself, respect your outfit, respect your family and your community that you come from, because that all shows when you're out there on the dance floor.
From the day that we could walk, my father brought us into this circle to teach us the traditional way, the drumming, the dancing.
It's adult members of the tribe, like Ron Walsey, that dedicate themselves to help and teach that sense of pride to the younger generations.
We go to powwows, you know, we get these kids, we try to teach them, come and sit down with us because this is our gang, you know, we'll bring them in. He's the leader, I'm the next leader. You know, only beating that we do is what we do to the drum.
Learning those traditions, learning those songs, and then just being with their people, being with their friends, their family, you know, positive, good role models that are around them, and being together, you know, a three-day weekend with their families, being alcohol and drug-free, busy, happy, healthy, that there's nothing better than that.
Perhaps, even more importantly, learning the old ways teaches the youngsters that having pride in yourself and your heritage means there's no place for substance abuse in your life.
And it goes back to their sense of identity, to where there are prohibitions in the Native culture for abusing alcohol and drugs. I mean, it was considered a dishonor a long time ago to even be under the influence of anything. You weren't allowed to participate in certain ceremonies. So there's those cultural prohibitions that don't encourage alcohol and drug use.
If you're under the influence, you know, that's not being a very good role model as a singer or a dancer. Alcohol and drugs is not a tradition of our Indian people, and we want to bring that back and have our powwows, have our gatherings and our ceremonies, you know, alcohol and drug free.
When we do it, it brings a lot of disrespect to yourself, so I respect myself a lot.
and it appears to be working. We ask members of the Burns Paiute Tribe Powwow Club if they like dancing.
I love it. It makes me feel good.
Makes me feel happy.
Keeping me healthy. Keeping me in shape. Give me something to do in my spare time. Out of trouble.
Keeps me away from drugs and alcohol. It keeps me active and fit. Brings me to social life. I have a lot of social opportunities when I go to powwows.
We also asked if dancing gave them a sense of history and tradition.
It teaches you what your native ways are. I learned about tradition by the elders.
Before my grandma passed away this year, she used to tell me how they used to eat or what they ate and what they did.
New dance moves, tradition.
I want to keep doing it, and so keeping it a tradition, meaning I will carry it on to my kids, and my kids carry it on to their kids. So I want it to stay in the circle.
This is our sacred circle. You know, you come into this circle, you know, you're feeling bad, you know, have bad feelings, leave them outside, you know, don't bring them inside the circle, because that's how my grandfather taught me, you know, you go to a powwow, you go there with a good heart, you go there to have fun, you go there to sing, dance.
The sense of pride and history being instilled in Native American kids today is also having an unexpected effect.
Native Americans have the highest percentage of completely abstaining from alcohol and drugs. So where the majority of the population might drink on occasion and it might not be a problem for them, many Native people completely abstain.
One of the key elements in guiding the next generation of Native Americans is strong leadership.
We can teach our kids, you know, the dangers, and they see it. You know, some of them have to grow up around it and live with it. And so they see it and they know that they want something different from their lives. So they know just to stay away from it completely.
Just growing up here in Warm Springs and being around a lot of alcoholism and drug addiction, and then being able to prevent myself from being engaged in that lifestyle. I mean, I just want to give somebody else that chance, because at some point many adults have let me down. So I want to be one of the adults that doesn't let youth down.
Singing and dancing just doesn't do it for some kids, so the Nine Tribes of Oregon had developed other programs to help show them the way.
Personally, I mean, I was a Native youth growing up myself. I always looked up to role models that stepped out of their box and were able to come out to do things like this. I like camping, I like, you know, all the good stuff, rafting, archery, horseback riding, and I think that, you know, by showing these kids that I can step outside my box, that I'm able to help them possibly through some of their stuff that they might be going through. And realistically, we're just out here to have fun, give them alternatives to drugs and alcohol, and a little healthy environment for them.
Shane is one of several counselors putting on this camp near Hehe Butte, 18 miles north of Warm Springs.
We try to be as modern but traditional at the same time as possible. You know, music styles are different, but we all have the same love and passion for music, so we try to connect through different ways, maybe not distinctly through the same exact ways, but what we're really trying to do is just give them the opportunity to express themselves through their own personality and their own type of style, and just share with them the stuff that we used to do when we were their age. And we connect through, you know, stories that are similar of stuff. And so I think that's really what it is just trying to connect with them through their styles, and then adapting our styles to be able to talk with them and really have a good time.
This camp offers Native kids the opportunity to experience the great outdoors, camping, archery, crafts, and horseback riding. While loosely structured, this camp is designed to help kids facing multiple risk factors by reminding them about their heritage.
It brings our capacity towards self-destruction down quite a bit if our protective factors are addressed. Respect for elders, and that's been identified based on what the youth told us. The belief in the importance of having Native values, those are like the top two. Taking responsibility for what they do, trying their hardest, enjoying school. I mean, those have been the main ones in Warm Springs, specifically identified here in this tribal community.
Without question, the highlight of the week was when Ramona Cochran and John Spence brought several horses to camp, dispensing a little equine therapy.
The point of having them around the equine is to learn patience, to learn confidence, and to learn trust.
This kind of therapy brings out a lot. You'll be grooming a horse with a kid, and they'll open up about a lot of other stuff. And then the feedback you get, and you'd wonder, how in the heck would this transfer over to doing better schoolwork or getting along better with the parents? But that's what the parents and the counselors tell us.
Mona and John are not only loosening these kids up, they are restoring their connection to their heritage.
All of us here is trying to revive this tribal tradition of horses because of land loss, therefore habitat loss, and poverty, alcohol and drugs. We lost a lot of this tradition with horses and the spiritual part. I think there's a spiritual connection with horses and tribal people.
As with the powwow, this camp seems to be showing positive results.
I believe that not only the tradition, but the spiritual uplifting and the openness, and then the bonding with one another, and then the good feeling that comes out of them in a genuine way, you know, that's what I've seen.
Today's Native American youth are faced with numerous challenges, and the temptation to escape is always there, particularly to those that live on the reservation.
When I was little, I was growing up around it a lot because my mom and dad were alcohols.
Well, it's like drugs, alcohol, they were always there. Like even now I could get alcohol and drugs anytime I want. All I have to say is I want to get high, I want to get stoned, and about 20 people would be there to get me whatever I needed and they wouldn't have to pay for it.
The 9 federally recognized tribes of Oregon and urban Indians have learned that bringing back the native ways and traditions are having a positive impact on these kids.
They're here, they're with the earth, they're connecting with the equine, and then the timber, the water, and so you have all of these elements here that these children are connecting with.
Since I've been here, it's been fun, so I might like it.
We both said that we weren't gonna like it.
Yeah.
Then we end up liking it.
Personally, in my mind, just having the kids say that they want to come here to these camps is a success in my eyes.
I went rafting yesterday.
Yeah.
That was pretty fun, then going horse riding today.
Hope guides you, keeps you going, believing in something better, something good to come, to where you just never want to give up. And hopefully we're trying to pass that on to these kids.
I've heard it called magic, and that's it. I mean, it's just, it's an incredible high to see this happen.
It's very contemporary nowadays, but we still remember what the meaning is behind our dances, and it's always to pray and to heal and to dance for those people that can't dance.
It's everything. It's so much fun.
We try to bring lift their spirits up, make them feel better inside and outside.
It makes me feel like really happy and just great.
Merle, you want to start a song?
In 1989, the Pacific Northwest tribes revived a tradition of bringing together their people to celebrate the connection to salmon, water, and each other. Those who participated in the first paddle to Seattle in 1989 realized that this journey could provide a resurgence of the traditional ways of the canoe culture. These first paddlers decided to form an intertribal canoe society and hold the event every year. Over the last 22 years, the canoe journey has helped to bring back Northwest indigenous languages, foster the canoe family song and other songs, and provide an avenue for healing. The canoe journey occurs annually each summer on the Salish Sea. Hosting of the annual event rotates among the Northwest tribes and Canadian First Nations. Canoes leave from their homelands and travel to the host tribe. The canoe journey can last several weeks, depending on where the canoes have started. Some canoes leave as early as the first week in July and paddle on the open waters for up to 3 weeks. The canoe journey has also served to aid in addressing and healing the problems that plague indigenous people, such as alcohol and substance abuse and suicide.
We are Ichiwanapum! We are Ichiwanapum! We are Ichiwanapum! We travel with people from the Clatsop Nehalem, and also from Tulalip. We're asking permission to leave your shores. Paddles in the water!
Swinomish 2011! Woo!
This is probably one of the biggest drug and alcohol prevention native pushes on the whole West Coast. It's the biggest gathering on the West Coast for natives, and really emphasizing on drug and alcohol free. Also because of the bigger cities, gang awareness and numerous other things, just to try and keep them in a positive sense of mind and that there's so many better things in life besides being that way. All of our people were canoe people in Grand Round. We come from about 30 different bands of people, five main tribes, but a bunch of different small bands of people. Coming from the Willamette Valley, the Columbia River, and the coast, we were all canoe people with canoe religion and longhouse and everything. But when we were relocated to Grand Round from our ceded lands, there was never a need for them because we weren't anywhere near a big river anymore. And so from 1855 till 2005, there's never been any canoes in Grand Round. Back in 2003, we had seen the canoes come into Tulalip and seen all the kids and everything that was going on. And so we decided that, started talking to people about it and what it actually meant to be doing this and be in the canoes. And finally in 2005, a small group of us went and we asked council to help sponsor us to go on this trip. Our first year out, very trying, a lot of learning. It was kind of like a revitalization of canoe culture, an awakening of the canoe spirit, I guess you'd say. We came home with all these feelings and all these pictures to show all the things that we'd done and all the accomplishments we'd made and people we had met. It was just like, we need to have this. Something's been missing. And we found a piece of it. And so we got a canoe, now we've got a few canoes, and now we're carving canoes. Everything that we've done has flooded into our community, from the singing to the kids, into our preschools. It's just flooded into every one of those areas because of that first journey that we'd had.
One, two, three, up.
So from 2005 to now, we've gone from like 20 people to a couple hundred people.
I realized that it was way more like intense, and it's a life-changing experience, and I didn't realize it was such a big deal.
I felt like I wanted to go back to Boston.
I really wasn't involved in the tribe that much until about now.
Our kids that live outside the reservation live in the inner cities, Portland and Eugene and Salem, the big cities around us. There's not much there for them. And this has definitely put a lot of things into their little communities that have helped them a lot.
Like, I had no idea about anything, really. And then just coming out here taught me so much, and I just, like, what I'm really a part of.
I wanted to see how they did it, like, before us, and how it was for them, like our ancestors.
We really focus on a lot of our families, but we also focus on kids at risk, foster kids, kids within the system.
Turned out fun. Canoeing's hard.
I thought it would be really easy, but it's really hard. You just paddle just for, like, 6-7 hours straight.
That's an extension of your ancestor. You know, you're touching, you know, you're paddling, you're doing basically, you're walking in the same footsteps your ancestors might have walked in or crossed, you know, and it just gives you a sense of where you might, you know, where you come from. And it's just it's a good feeling.
It was fun. It hurt the first time, my arms were getting sore, but the second time it was easy and I got a blister. Blister is a good thing. It means you've been doing it right.
Yeah.
Yep. They're kind of red, not really. They're going away now.
It's a lot of hard work and it requires a lot of teamwork and getting along with people and you know, getting to know new people and what your ancestors went through a long time ago.
It's interesting to me because I like history and all the canoe stuff.
It really gives them a sense of who they are, where they come from, an actual sense of, oh, well, these are the people I actually come from. These canoes, I belong to these canoes, they're a part of me.
I'm gonna respect the land and respect like what I've learned from this journey and about my ancestors and what they went through and embrace what I have today.
Well, I've learned more of our traditions, our songs, what we do.
I'm in love with Canoe Journey. It makes us show who we are and what we do and how we live.
You grow into your role within the tribe. You know, each one of us has a purpose, something that we contribute to. That's what makes a tribe, and so that's what we teach the kids.
Tournament people, we're from Grand Round, Oregon, traveling in our canoe, Stonkia. We also have two guests with us from New Zealand. We have some Maoris with us. Answering your call for our canoes, asking permission to come ashore, bring our family, bring our elders, bring our children with us, bring our ancestors with us, asking permission to come ashore. Hi, Master Zoom.
Thank you. Thank you for your travels. Welcome our friends from far away. Thank you for traveling with our relatives. Come ashore. Come eat, come sleep, come dance, come sing. Thank you, come ashore.
Best thing? I don't know. It's all so good.
Out on the water, the beautiful scenery, hanging out with people, you know, having fun, laughs, and having a good time.
Paddling, my favorite first. Singing and dancing and experiencing new cultures.
The best part would be learning more.
Protocol makes me want to know more about it and stuff like that.
My favorite part is the singing part and showing other tribes what we do.
Singing and dancing and having fun. Up on stage, in front of everybody, giving it what we got, showing what we can give.
When you're coming ashore and you see all those people cheering, it makes you feel like you're in the spotlight, you know, almost like I'm somebody, you know, kind of. And so it was really growing up, not really being put out there like that, to where you're, you know, you feel somewhat belonging and stuff like that. And the songs that we started singing and all the songs that started coming back. It seems like feeding somewhat of my soul, singing songs and being a part of this. So it's just, it's addiction.
The Grand Round Canoe family is one of about 120 families that made the journey to Swinomish, Washington from their homelands. Hundreds of people undertaking a strenuous and life-altering journey to renew their ties with their ancestors.
Permission to come ashore!
And everyone on the journey alcohol and drug-free. It's an impressive show of strength and commitment.
It felt really good, hearing everyone cheering for our canoe family.
I like being center of attention for a little bit.
Once again, we've learned that keeping our kids involved in the traditions and history of their tribe serves to remind them that they can have fun. avoid alcohol and drugs, and grow inside and out.
I've lived around it in my family a lot, so I've seen what it can do to families, so I don't like it.
I drank before, and coming to this, it just knowing that that is criteria, it just makes it that much more important to me that we're bringing our youth into that and exposing them with all the other adults that can show you this is a good way to live, and it's not all you don't have to be on drugs or alcohol to enjoy life. Come paddle to a shore where there's 10,000 people screaming for you, and you'll fill up with that, and you won't need nothing else. So
most of our tribe has problems, and the CAR families must do it, and we don't want to do that. We'd rather do something better and different, change.
I've never wanted to, never thought about it. I'm never going to my whole entire life.
The canoe journey has made more than one tribe believers in themselves, their heritage, and their future.
Yeah, I love it.
Better man. I think I am.
Feels good. Makes you feel energized, excited, heartwarming.
It felt good. Like the feeling that you get inside when you're pulling, you feel good.
I love it. The camping part's fun. The the canoe journey itself, pulling out in the water. I love it all. Anyway, it's good.
I want to be just like my dad.
The best part is knowing that your kids are all in a safe place.
To see the kids in front of me and just taking themselves, to taking time out of their lives to be a part of something bigger than themselves, and a lot of them, like I said, not having parents that are real active, but this is a way for us to help them a little bit, to give them a sense of something that they've been missing, to get them maybe out of the little bit of day-to-day chaos that some of them are in.
Awesome. That's all I can really say.
At the very end, it's overwhelming.
It's up.
It's up.
It's up.
Sweat Lodge here at Victor Bates Place in Umatilla is a key component of that tribe's effort to keep Native kids in a positive frame of mind.
Well, this lodge here has been down here for over 100 years at least.
Wow.
This is the womb of Mother Earth. That's why it's shaped like that, like the womb. When you go in, we crawl in backwards, because when you leave the womb, you're coming out head first, so when you go in backwards. The lodge, everybody hollers, right? You know that? And they howl like a coyote or war whoop, and then you get let out. Because it's just like leaving your mother's womb, you're leaving the womb of Mother Earth, so we holler. That's why we holler when we leave. You're cleansing yourself, and if you don't rinse it away, then you're just going to take it with you when you leave. And then, so you want to get in the water and wash it all the bad away.
Oftentimes you shed tears in there over the losses in your life, the fears. You let go of the anger. You cleanse yourself so that when you come out, you feel renewed, restored, cleansed all the way around, inside and out. And you see the world. You're calmer, more balanced, and it's a beautiful day. And you're ready to go again.
I couldn't live without it. I mean, I've got to have it. If I go 3 or 4 days with that sweat, it's like, man, I gotta get out there, you know. It's how we treat each other, how we respect each other, how we respect ourselves and nature.
Respecting ourselves, respecting nature, and developing one spirituality is the principal theme behind the Umatilla Tribe's week-long camp called Life Takes Courage.
The principles behind the Life Takes Courage camp is to give Native youth the skills to help their peers when they're feeling suicidal, to give them the tools to help.
For 5 full days, Native kids from the 9 tribes of Oregon gather here in the hills outside Pendleton to spend time together, make new friends, and learn a little bit about the positive things in life.
The training here this week at Westminster Retreat Site is called Native Hope. HOPE is an acronym, Helping Our People Endure, and it's a Native Youth Suicide Prevention Program developed in 2003. It's peer counseling, in other words, youth helping youth. Around suicide prevention, and we also address the related risk factors, which are substance abuse, violence and bullying, stress and trauma, and depression.
Many Native kids have already been exposed to multiple risk factors, and Clayton travels the country teaching them how to overcome the sometimes negative cycles of life on the reservation. He does it with energy, humor, and song, all the while wrapping the message in tradition and heritage. He divides the kids into 4 clans, and for 2 days, they have to work together to solve problems, meet challenges, and compete against other clans.
We're gonna go immediately into our clan competition, so circle your clan standing. The winning clan, everybody in that clan gets a gift card, so motivate a little bit, fire up your clan. In Indian country, we have a lot of gloom and doom and Chicken Little and the sky is falling and just cynical, negative thinking, and it doesn't get us anywhere. So we focus on strengths, and the strengths that we really stress for our youth are things like spirituality, positive friends, positive activities, generosity, volunteering, having healthy adults in your life. So if our youth focus on these support systems, the monsters that we say, we have a coyote story where coyote kills the monster. And as I tell that story to our participants, the monster emerges as a metaphor and a symbol for drugs and alcohol addictions, suicide, drinking and driving, teenage pregnancy, bullying, and domestic violence, and the list goes on. We all have these symbolic monsters in our life as Native people. And so we've seen our parents and grandparents, uncles and aunties, act inappropriately regarding these monsters. And we witness that and we see it and we become dysfunctional as well. And so the goal for our young people is to break the cycle of this unhealthy way of coping with the monsters in our life. Let me explain why addressing our hostility is important.
Clayton's message is about healing and helping others heal too.
I think healing is so important with anybody that has been a victim of any type of abuse, whether it's child neglect, child abuse, sexual abuse.
This morning we're gonna work on peer-to-peer video presentations. I'm gonna assign each of the 4 clans a topic, and then you're gonna put together a 60-second or less positive message about that problem. Suicide prevention, teen pregnancy, bullying prevention. How do you stop bullying? Getting dumped. You're gonna present the problem, but don't dwell on it. Focus on sources of strength, which include peers, adults, programs, culture, spirituality, health professionals, and so on. Include strengths that help to overcome that problem.
After about a half hour of preparation, each team is given the floor to present their case.
Oh,
broken heart takes time.
And the winner?
All right, we are clan number 3, and we are the Fry Bread Investigators, and we are half Indian, half amazing. So we're doing suicide prevention. I'm gonna let the kids take it away.
I don't, can't take it anymore. I might think just kill myself.
Whatever. Party!
All right, scenario 2.
I can't take this anymore. I think I might just kill myself.
You're my best friend. You don't need to kill yourself.
There's always help around you. Thank you guys.
Thanks.
Group hug.
Get over here.
Our slogan is, there's always help around you. All right, give it up for the FBI. Walk that around. Walk it around.
Working together.
Joe!
Helping one another and developing positive influences is the primary goal this week. Back on the Umatilla Reservation, leadership and guidance have gathered in abundance at the Longhouse for a traditional dinner.
It's very important to teach young children about this because the generations before us worked for what we have today. And this is how it goes from generation to generation. And this generation today is working because of what we were taught. And this is what we're trying to teach our young people today, is the same thing. So that when we're gone, they'll be doing the same thing what we did here this evening. Speaking the language, eating the foods, singing the songs, and following the same traditions.
Next was the deer. The deer, it named itself and prepared itself for the Indian people.
All of our ceremonies that we have here in the Longhouse center around our foods. Our foods, we recognize through our religion, through song, our language, and our tradition. And this food, this Indian food, what we call the salmon, the deer, the roots, and the berries, they're all sacred to us because they were created first. This food, when it was created, made a promise to take care of us as Indian people. And we, in turn, take care of it through our religion, through ceremony, through song.
It's a form of identity to keep them on the right path so that they know who their people were and where they came from, and it'll be a good starting point for their future.
The next morning dawns bright and clear, both literally and philosophically, and the next generation is enjoying a day of outdoor fun.
All right. Yep.
We sent a small camera along with the kids, and they interviewed each other about their experiences this week.
Try to live life to the fullest, but I can't. Only at the age of 16 and I'm a man. And I hustle for my money like a bee to get his honey. And I get more power than the Energizer Bunny. So I'm so fresh, man, I'll be the best. When it comes to the wicked, yo, there ain't no rest. And the hating gets stopped when I come up in the spot. When I spit my rhymes, all the honey's jaws got. I'm dipped from the feeder, rocking my Adidas. When haters come to me, yo, they get beat up.
Did you get any new friends on the trip?
Me? Yeah, I got you. And I got her, and I got that guy, and I got that other girl.
And your mom.
I met him. He's my new friend.
Justin. Wait. How do you like the camp?
I like it, but I hate the camp.
Well, the camera loves you. All right. The camera
loves you. Oh, homeboy, how you rhyme so tight. You know you got your lyrics sounding so out of sight.
What's up, Marito?
What's up?
This camp is awesome.
What did I learn from it? That I'm not alone and that there's others out there like me.
Did you learn anything?
Yes, I learned things like to be there for your friends and to always stay on the positive side.
Did you meet new people?
No.
No? You knew everybody?
Yeah, I knew everybody.
Making new friends, sharing experiences, and learning more about the backstory, the story of their heritage.
It's a story of how strong our culture is, how strong our ceremonies and songs and stories are, that if we stay anchored in our native way of life, that no matter what adversity comes into the path of our young people, they will have the resiliency and the skills and the tools to overcome them, and to walk into that light of goodness that's truly intended for them.
And it's about healing and helping each other.
Finding your own way to heal, whatever it is, whether it's through your traditional ways, whether it's through the Christian ways, whatever. I think it is so important that we lead by example, that we're not drinking and using drugs and telling them not to. We have to walk the talk.
Singing can keep you away from alcohol and drugs. Our traditional foods can keep you away from alcohol and drugs. Our way of life can keep you away from alcohol and drugs.
Perhaps the best advice to all of us is given by Chet Tyus.
That it was better to be myself than to be somebody else, to be a leader instead of following.
Don't be phony, let's keep it real. Share from your heart a true appeal. Keep on giving, it's the native way. It's never too late, tomorrow's a new day.
A permanent solution to a temporary pain. Keep on living, don't leave us in vain. Life takes courage, we must stay strong. There's always hope, please don't end your song.
This is Sarah. This song is dedicated to the Native youth and the Native communities. Always remember that someone's saying a prayer for you, and we care.